that they were actually blocking the use of VirusTotal. So if you wanted to, on this machine, go to VirusTotal, it wouldn't connect. So that's pretty sus. Hi friends, welcome back to the channel. Are you gonna be on my blue team? If you're new here, my name's Ash, I'm 27, I'm a cybersecurity enthusiast, and on this channel we do CTFs, either Jeopardy or live, and we learn together on our way to being a cybersecurity professional. On today's video, we will be going over another TryHackMe room called Investigating Windows. For my notes on this room and all my others, and most of the commands that I use, see hack notes in the description below, and there you can find links and other timestamps and anything else you need. Okay, let's go. So we're in TryHackMe and we're on Investigating Windows. So our description reads, a Windows machine has been hacked. It's your job to go investigate this Windows machine and find clues to what the hacker might have done. So let's select Start Machine. So we've got a single task here and it reads, Investigating Windows. This is a challenge that is exactly what it says on the tin. There are a few challenges around investigating a Windows machine that has been previously compromised. Connect to the machine using remote desktop protocol. The credentials the machine are as follows. A little bit of a typo. Administrator and let me in 123 exclamation mark. Please note that the machine does not respond to ping or ICMP packets and may take a few minutes to boot. So let's get on the network firstly. So first things first is we need to remote desktop. So let's go ahead and copy our username. There are a few RDP programs. I'm gonna use Romania. So we can select here RDP. It also does VNC and SSH. What we actually want is the IP first. So let's use the IP and select enter. It's gonna say, hey, do you wanna accept the certificate? Now we're gonna be prompted with our username. So we can type it out, but I like to copy and paste. That way I just know that it's exactly like it should be. Let's hit okay. Let's full screen Romania. And to get our RDP session at a higher resolution, we can go on the side here and we can say resize window to fit remote resolution. Toggle full screen mode. Oh, there it is. Toggle dynamic resolution update. That's going to tell our remote session to go to the same resolution as our window. So as I'm opening up, I can see connecting to 1043, was it 34? 423. So that was kind of interesting. There was something funky going on as we booted this machine up. So we can also see that PowerShell has opened. Now remember, we are looking at a machine that has been compromised. So as us newbies, we need to determine between what's just set up for this event, for this room, and then what's a little bit sus. So seeing pop-up windows in this environment may not be too unusual, but for the sake of this room, we know that it has been compromised. It's a little bit sus. Connecting to a remote IP, flashing PowerShells. It's not great. Okay, so we looks like everything has booted up. Let's go over our questions and start tackling this machine. So first up, we've got what's the version and year of this Windows machine? So there's a few ways that we can find out that information. I've always just right-clicked this PC and gone properties. So we can see here some information, the operating system, processor, how much RAM, the computer name, but we can also right-click the Windows Start and go Command Prompt Admin. Now we are admin in this case, so we've got full control. There's no way of zooming in, but I'm writing system info. So here we can see some of the same information, like the operating system name, the host name or computer name, extra things like the registered organization, amazon.com. Now that's going to be because that this is a VM running on AWS, but that doesn't have anything to do with actually our challenge. But we also do have the DHCP server, and we also have the IP address of this system, which looks like a virtual NIC running on Amazon. So we have another pop-up here, tmpmim.exe. So that's super sus. So it looks like something's running on a schedule to have something just pop open like that. So it looks like we can also navigate that. So we'll look at that in a sec. Let's just keep going with our questions. So what's the version and the year of this machine? So this is indeed a Windows 2016 operating system. So next up, we've got which user logged in last. So while we're in CMD, we can use a couple of commands and that I learned for this room. Get with a capital G dash local user. Now these are not going to work because these are PowerShell commands and we are running in command prompt. So let's go open up PowerShell. Get local user. That's better. So we've got administrator and looks like we've got a default account, a guest account, Jenny and John. So we can start getting some information about the different users. So let's hit up arrow and go select dot last logon. And this should be showing the usernames and when they've last logged in. For some reason, it's not showing for me, so I'm gonna do them separately. separately. So we've got name and then last logon. So these last logon dates should be next to our users. Not really sure why it's not working, but we can use administrator, which is the current date, that's how I've logged in. And we've also got some other information about another user. The question being, which user last logged in? Well, that's us, because we've just logged in now. Our next question though, when did John log into the system? And we have a format to answer that in. Well, we've already got that here. So let's go ahead and copy that, paste it in, and we'll just go ahead and add some zeros here to follow the format. And that looks like right. So what IP does the system connect to when it first starts? So I did see it. It was like 34.0.1 or something. I nearly caught it, but since I didn't, there's a few ways to find this out. So let's go onto the start menu and let's type in reg edit, and we can get the registry editor. So starting off in HKey local machine software, then we go under Microsoft, scroll down to Windows, then under current version. Lastly, we're looking for the run, and we can see under here we've got something unusual, and there we have our pop-ups again. So we'll be looking at that very shortly, but we can see in here that there is something, a command to run. So it looks like it runs this p.exe-s looking to an IP address. Now that's what I saw at the beginning. I was really close. It's 2.3. We have net user, and it looks like it's redirecting that into 02.txt. So there's something funky going on in this temporary folder. So let's go ahead and grab this IP address. So we'll paste that in. Great. So let's look at the next question. What two accounts had administrative privileges other than the administrator? So as there always is in Windows, there's a few ways that we can look at this. If we right click the start menu, we can open up computer management. Then under local users and groups, we can select groups. And by default, there's an administrators group. So we can double click that, and we can see a list of the other users, the members of this group. So there's us, the administrator, and then there's our other two users, Guest and Jenny. So let's go ahead and type them in. Next up, we've got what's the name of the scheduled task that is malicious. Now, if you are a Windows user, you may have used the task scheduler. So this is sort of pointing us in the right direction. So let's hit our Windows key and type in task, and we're looking for the task scheduler. So on the left-hand side, let's look under the task schedule library, and we'll click that, and we can see we've got a few things. So the first thing we've got here is an Amazon EC2 launch, which is going to be a part of the VM. So that's nothing to interest us. We've got check logged in. Then we've got clean file system. That sounds pretty innocent. And then we have flash update 22 spelt wrong. Game over and update Windows. So these are sounding a bit sus. Looks like they've put in by the administrator. As the admin, I didn't do these, so it's a little sus. Now we have this reoccurring date, so we need to dig a little bit into more about this. So looking at our answer format, we're looking for three words. So out of our questions here, there's only one that lines up with three words. So let's start by looking here. This is scheduled to run at a certain time every day. And if we click on the actions tab, it says start a program. So again, in that temporary folder, super sus folder. I really need to go check that out. It's clearly doing something funky. So it looks like it's running NC, which if you're familiar with Netcat, it's probably that. .ps1, the PowerShell file extension. So this looks like a PowerShell version of Netcat is running a port -l for listen on 1348. It's being sent something that it's receiving. Very, very sus. So we look at our name, clean file system. So let's go ahead and type that in. And our next task we've got is what file was a task trying to run daily? Now that was under that actions tab. We've got this file nc.ps1. Alrighty. What port did the file listen locally for? So that's also here, that -l flag specifying the listening port of 1348. Next up, we've got when did Jenny last log in? So that's kind of interesting. So if we go back to our PowerShell, we did get information from the get local command of the last login. We didn't actually have anything for Jenny. It's a little bit confusing because we are looking for something to be typed in. So what exactly? So there's another command that we can use called net user. This again lists out our user account, similar to get local user, but this time we can find out some more information if we specify the user. So if we just specify Jenny, because that's what we're being asked, here we can see a little bit more, like the full name, country, region code, code, if the account is active or expires. So the password last set on this particular date, again, this date is coming up. Password expires is never. And if we keep going down, we've got the last logon, never. And this is sort of what it's our question's actually looking for. So we can go ahead and type in never there. Awesome. Okay, so we're doing pretty cool. We haven't really investigated into what this malicious software is doing. We definitely know that this has been a compromised system. So at what date did the compromise take place? So the date that keeps coming up again and again, we can see here when Jenny was last logged in. If we go back to our task scheduler, this date is popping up everywhere. All of these schedules were all done on that same date. So I'm going to say March the 2nd, 2019. Next up, we've got at what time did Windows first assign special privileges to a new logon? So this one's a little bit more tricky. So we're going to be using Event Viewer. This is the log application we've got in Windows. So on the left pane, we can see Windows logs. So we've got a couple of different types: application, security setup system, and forwarded events. So since this is asking us about special privileges logon, this is going to be under the security. So once we've selected security, we can see that there's a total of over 2,000 events. So that's a lot to comb through. So if we drag in from the right this actions pane, we can filter our current logs. So then it's the question of what and how do we actually filter this down? So the way Windows logs works is it uses event IDs. So if you look behind, we can see here special login 4672, logon 4624. So these are all these task categories all have an event ID assigned to them. So if we look up our Windows log and we're looking for special privileges logon, but we're looking for the event ID. So we can see here that we've got event log ID 4672. So let's go ahead and type that in. So now we have a list of 305 events. So yeah, we've combed it down, but it's still a lot to go one by one. So if we look at our hints, it's sort of helping us along because there are so many entries, it's not wanting us to go and waste our time. So it's going to end in the 49th second. So we've got one here that ends in 49. So considering that the date is the current date, that's gonna be us, that's not what we're looking for. So let's scroll down past our current date and then let's look for something that ends in 49. So we do have different dates. So I'm actually thinking, why don't we filter this down even further? So we can select a logged range. And since we know when the day of the event that it happened, we can just search for that date. So 3rd of the 2nd, 2019, and then 2/3 of the 2nd, 2019, 11:59 p.m. So that's gonna be the whole day that the hack took event. Okay, so now we've got that down to 64. So I should have done this earlier. So after a quick scroll through, we can quickly find our special login that we're after. So we can right click and copy details as text. We can just quickly open up Notepad and we can go ahead and extract that date. And we'll just need to add those zeros at the front and then we've got our correct date. So next up, we've got what tool was used to get Windows passwords. So now let's go ahead and investigate that temp folder. So if we go back to our file explorer, we keep seeing those pop-ups and it's going to see TMP. So this is the file that we've got. We can see a backdoor, a PowerShell script. We can see our Netcat PowerShell script that's listening from an incoming service. So this is not good. This is where the hacker, the bad actor has left their goodies. So let's go through what we can see so far. We have a D file, looks like some sort of system information. We then have this MIM-out. Now, this looks like some sort of program, a command tool or something. So if we give this a search, we can see Mimikatz is both an exploit on Microsoft Windows that extract passwords stored in memory and software that performs that exploit. So we definitely have the tool. This is malware. So what was the attacker's external control and command server's IP? So we have another question below about DNS poisoning that's sort of pointing us in the right direction here. That's going to help with this question. So if we open up File Explorer, we can go into the C drive, Windows, we can look for System32, then scroll down to drivers, and then we'll find our etsy file, which is going to have a few important files, but this one called hosts, we can go ahead and open that with Notepad. So in here is where DNS poisoning can happen. This file is responsible for what IPs on this system are going to go to what domains. So if you're working on a website, for example, you may want to block out the IP of the live website so you can test out the local version or another version, or there's a few reasons that you want to use it. In this case, we can see that they were actually blocking the use of VirusTotal. So if you wanted to, on this machine, go to VirusTotal, it wouldn't connect. So that's pretty sus. But if we look down the bottom, we've got Google.com. Google.com has a recognizable DNS that you might even use. This is definitely not it. 7632971 32. Let's give that a copy. So this is definitely our external control and command server. Great, so now we have that. What was the extension name of the shell uploaded via the server's website? So this is another tricky one that took me a little while. If we go back to our C drive, we can see that there's an INET. Now apparently this has something to do with ISS, which is how we can run web servers in Windows Server. It's not something that I've used, but we can see in here is where we have our shell. So they most likely got a foothold in, spun up a web server so that they could then upload a shell, activated that shell so that they could get a reverse shell, and then they could get full access that way. Maybe. I'm really not an expert. I'm just sort of guessing. So it looks like they've used this .jsp. So this .jsp looks like a Jakarta server pages. It's a collection of technologies that helps software developers create dynamically generated web pages on HTML, XML, SOAP, and other document types. So it's similar to PHP and ASP. So definitely responsible for a web server and could definitely have a shell. Great, so our last two questions here, we've got what is the last port that the attacker opened? Now, if we look at the hint for this one, we've got firewall. So that's going to direct us to where we need to go. Let's hit the Windows key and type in fire. We've got Windows firewall and advanced security. So considering that our inbound rules, this is what allows incoming connections, works in what was last opened. So we should see here pretty much, yep, at the very top. And that's leet, L-E-E-T for 1337. That's definitely something to look out for in these CTFs. So we've got 1337. And the last question is check for DNS poisoning, which we did earlier. So if we go back to our hosts file, remember we had google.com poisoned. So that is our CTF investigating Windows. I hope you enjoyed this Microsoft Windows forensics blue team room. I always think that I'm going to enjoy red team more than blue team. And then I go and do one of these rooms and I find it absolutely fascinating following the trail. I love the whole investigation element. So I hope you enjoyed going through this room too. I actually learned so much about Windows and I'm excited for more rooms like this. This was actually really difficult. I think in these CTFs, we get quite used to using like Linux and terminals. So then to go back to Windows, which is like what I am more familiar with, but there's just so many areas of Windows that I just haven't used and I haven't looked into. So this was a great room to sort of refresh and learn heaps of new things. So thank you so much for checking out this video. I appreciate you getting all the way through. If you want my notes to this room and all my other rooms that I've gone through, see hack notes in the description below. Feel free to do all that YouTube stuff. And I want to let you in on a little secret. There might be something coming up in March. So just a little bit of a tease there. Something exciting that I'm keen to share with you. Just a little way of saying thank you. Up on the screen is the last capture the flag that I did that goes over encoding, steganography, and a lot of other important areas of capture the flags and cybersecurity in general. So definitely go check that out if you haven't. Otherwise, thanks for watching again, and I will see you in the next one.